online broadcast network, AfterBuzz TV. Over 20 million weekly downloads in over 150 countries and your number one source for after-show entertainment. AfterBuzz TV, the destination for TV superfans, producing aftershows for over 300 of your favorite TV shows, interviewing celebrities and showrunners, and bringing you behind-the-scenes exclusives. All thanks to E! Entertainment's Maria Menounos, producer Kevin Undergaro, and internet leader Akamai. Now, let the buzz begin! Yes.
Hey there, Z Nation fans. Welcome to another episode of the AfterBuzz Recap Show. How are you all doing tonight?
Hey there, Z Nation fans. Welcome to another episode. I can't do it.
Yeah, are we actually here tonight? Is this real?
No, this is my dream you guys are in.
Oh, is it yours, though? Or
which
is
means
it
you're
Megan's
gonna die.
Dreaming about your dream?
It's a
and
dream
then, so
within
it's
a dream.
Actually Katie's dream. And
then Zach's gonna wake up and go, "What the
I'm
heck?"
I don't remember my dreams, so
myself.
I don't remember my dreams.
My
so
dreams are
you're
awesome.
All hosts.
Yeah.
Who here has PTSD? That's how we'll determine whose dream this actually is.
This guy,
is.
He has no mustache.
Gotcha.
I lost my mustache in battle.
And all of the iTunes listeners are like, "Oh my God, is he okay?" Yeah, he just shaved.
Or anyone that's just listening is like, "Wait, he had a mustache?"
Yeah, that too.
Anyway, before we go on and figuring out what's real and what's not and who's actually here and who's actually a figment of our imaginations, we should probably introduce the panel. To my left, Katie Cullen.
Are we absolutely sure the show is not just going to restart suddenly?
It might. I don't know.
One of us may have to die first.
Oh, I'm not a fan of that. Roya Taheri.
I don't know where to go with that. I mean, Sean might be like, "Hey, we got to start over." That could be good. You know, you never know.
And I'm a beardless Zach Wilson.
The theme just starts playing again.
Anyway, but also joining us are two very, very special guests, Anastasia Baranova, who plays Addy.
Hi, guys.
And Michael Welch, who plays Mack, who are basically the stars of this episode.
Yay!
Thank you.
Oh.
We're getting a thumbs up from the booth like, yeah, we get you.
I have to ask, like, when you guys were going over the script for this one, what was your reaction? Because I started off this episode thinking Mack was going to end up dead, just based on the preview alone.
Yeah, I mean, this was a pretty crazy one. You know, we weren't in a couple in a row because we got separated from the group. And the way they ended up airing, they ended up putting this one before the next one. That's not the order in which we shot it. But yeah, I thought, you know, it was just, I thought it was a really cool opportunity. It was a unique challenge for me. I've never, like, carried a thing before throughout my career. And I really, like, you know, I for me personally, I mean, I really had a chance to experience the full range of, like, what human beings can experience. I mean, I remember after our first day filming, Stage, she looks at me and she goes, "You realize you went through every possible thing a human being can go through today. You were sad, angry, relieved, happy, emotional, like the whole spectrum." So it was pretty cool. And we actually, like, I mean, we like lived together in Spokane. We had like a little apartment together. So we went over this a lot and we talked about it a lot. I don't know. It was fun. I had a good time with it. How about you, Stage?
You're stupid. it was super, super great. I actually, Mike talking about it just now, I just got like really nostalgically excited to go back. And like, is it season two yet? Can it be next year? How was it reading it? I mean, going through the whole thing, like, yeah, it was really good, man. It was a whole episode of just us like having adventures and Mike being epic and me losing my mind. So, pretty, yeah, I mean, it was, I remember reading it and just being like, whew, he's got all the work. Good. Great.
Yeah, you just do a lot of screaming at the end.
A lot.
Like,
yeah,
wow.
Just lose my mind. Yeah.
But yeah, I was really surprised by this episode because I wasn't expecting Z Nation to do an episode like this, to have something like Groundhog Day, or I think you pointed out Edge of Tomorrow.
Run, Lola, Run.
Repeat. Whichever it's called. I don't know.
It's Edge of Tomorrow. Or isn't All You Need Is movie? Kill.
It was initially called All You Need Is Kill, but they changed it for marketing purposes. The graphic novel it's based on is All You Need Is Kill.
And then they changed to Edge of Tomorrow, and then they changed again when they released it on DVD to Live, Die, Repeat.
No, that's just the tagline.
Not anymore.
What?
You're kidding.
We're getting off topic.
What the hell, marketing? What the hell?
Anyway,
but this was Run Lola Run.
Yeah, it was very much Run Lola Run. And so I wasn't sure at first if it was real or if it was not, if it was a dream or if this was somebody's like dying, you know, something like a vision that they get like right before they're dying, you know, that sort of thing. I don't know. What was your guys' initial take?
Well, I remember watching it, getting through the first like 10 minutes or so and going, seriously, everything that they showed us in that preview was from a dream sequence? Come on, show. And then it kept repeating and repeating, like, oh, the whole show's a dream sequence. All right. That's a thing.
Yeah, I was going to be very angry if Mack ended up dying at the end. I was going to be like, okay.
All right.
Gotta go. You know what was funny?
Death. I'm not ready
is no longer
not
available
ready,
on that you know? Panel. Yeah.
I don't know if this is something I should reveal or not, but...
AfterBuzz exclusive. Do it.
One of the original notes from the Sci-Fi Network was, we love the episode, but... we don't know how we feel about the whole dreaming thing. And we kind of went, well, that's sort of the episode.
You just wanted to be stuck in a literal time loop? Like they drove into the 12th dimension or something and can't get out?
Yeah, I don't know.
Should have stayed by the flowers.
It's already zombies. Why not have time distortion?
Sure. It can turn into an episode of Doctor Who.
They would have had to roll literally through that. through an episode of the Twilight Zone for that to be physically possible.
I would watch that.
I would totally
Me
watch
too.
That TV
I would
program.
Watch that TV program. Too bad it was canceled decades ago. It goes black and white.
A guy comes out with a cigarette. Hello, you're in the Z zone.
Is that just the zone?
The zone. It would be the zone.
Zone.
Yeah.
Zone.
But anyway, it was...
We are so off topic.
Yeah. Well, I kind of don't even know how to go about recapping this because... Everything it does, it just repeats over and over again as slowly it gets revealed whose dream this actually is and then what happened to cause this sort of repressed memory. So it's cool, but I guess we can go ahead and start and try. Yeah. So it starts off with our couple. They've been separated from the rest of the group, as you mentioned, and they're not on the best terms right now. They're not happy with one another because obviously Mack wanted to go off on their own. Addy wanted to stay with the group, and now they've lost the group. So they're not really on the best terms right now.
Your guys' riding on the motorcycle remind me of Dumb and Dumber, though. I was waiting for one of you to be like, just pee, just let it go. Just let it go.
That's hilarious.
How did they survive the tsunami? We didn't see
they went
that
south.
At all.
They said they went south.
Right.
So they just
west.
Missed the entire thing?
We used our noodles.
Yeah, because they were traveling, the
west.
Tsunami was traveling west, right?
Yeah.
And then we,
okay.
Yeah, we sort of, by going south, I guess we just kind of missed
yeah,
it.
Yeah, zombies can't turn left.
Right.
Yeah. I did it! I turned left!
They can't open doors, they can't turn left. Makes
they
sense.
Can knock.
Raptors can knock,
Which,
too.
Again, it's an episode of Doctor Who now.
Anyway...
You keep bringing up Doctor Who, she's going to lose her mind over
yeah,
here.
I haven't watched my emotions.
I haven't watched last night's episode yet.
So. I haven't watched this. I haven't watched anything Capaldi.
Really?
I'm saving up.
Okay. So you can just binge watch it.
Yeah. And then you can
Sean,
watch the after
show.
Just
cue up the off-topic button. Cause we're yeah.
And then you can watch the after show, which airs on Monday night. And she's on it. Subject.
Anyway.
That's brilliant.
Anyway. A-host, try the entire panel.
Guys. Okay, let's get back to
Focus
it.
Focus up.
Get it together, everyone. Anyway, so they go, and initially they're going to stop at this creek, but... And kind of a weird line, like, beauty attracts trouble, you should know that. That was kind of a really passive-aggressive thing to say.
Oh, yeah, we're super snipey at the beginning of this episode. I think Mack is just kind of done at this point, you know, like... Every relationship needs its space, and we get no space.
It's actually frustrating.
We're
yeah.
just sick of each other, yeah. So that was completely directed at her. Yeah.
I mean, and it's stressful enough when, you know, families and couples go on road trips together anyway,
yeah.
And then you put, like, zombies in it. It's just all sorts of terrible.
I'm sure we can all relate to that.
Well, zombies.
It's a relationship built on trauma, and they go over that. It reminded me of the end of Speed.
Yeah. Because they say, you know, at the end of Speed, they say, oh, maybe we shouldn't be together because relationships built on trauma can't possibly last. And he's like, okay, well, we can base our relationship on sex then. I can deal with that. That works.
There are worse things in the world. It is the end of Speed.
Sorry?
It is the end of Speed.
Yeah, pretty much. But that's true. They go and find another place to camp out.
Because they ran out of fuel and got stuck there.
Oops. Yeah, oops.
Good job, everyone.
But you're absolutely right. We do find out how they ended up meeting, which was they met the night everything went to hell, and they've just been running together ever since. And it's kind of sad, but also kind of endearing.
Yeah. Go ahead.
I thought that was one of the the coolest things that, like, again, the show is pretty realistic. In the sense that if this were to happen, there are only so many, like, some people would live, some people would die, some people would survive because they're brains, some people brute force, whatever it is. And for the most part, it's like, yeah, we're the only two who made it out of this thing. And so then you just go and, you know, you don't really stop going.
And I thought it was interesting because it raises some interesting questions, at least in my mind, of, like, as a viewer watching, going, man, like, what is a relationship? I mean, forget the apocalypse. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like, what is that thing? It's two people connecting on some level. So from Mack's point of view, it's like, yeah, well, the way that we connect is we literally need each other. Like, that is so much more of a real relationship than any pre-apocalyptic relationship could ever be. And it's funny too, just the different perspectives, the male and female perspectives. Like, as a male watching the show, at the point, I don't know if this is the intended reaction, but at the point when Addy is like, listen, you know, we eat together, we kill together, we survive together, and we have sex together, but that's about it. And I'm going, that's it. I mean, that's compared to most married couples, I'd say we're ahead of the game. It sounds like a pretty good relationship.
What power is there?
I'd like to think most married couples don't go out and kill things a lot.
I would hope.
Just saying.
The ones in happy marriages do.
Exactly.
Maybe that's what they're doing wrong.
Yeah, the most healthy relationships go out and kill zombies together, right?
Are we thinking of Mr. and Mrs. Smith here? Because I'm talking real world, no zombies. If you're going out as a couple and killing other people, you got problems.
Whoa. Now you're bringing people into it. I'll just say kill stuff.
Anyway.
Stuff includes people.
Before we get off people topic again, I don't want the button. I don't want them to press the button and get me in trouble again.
Too late.
But what I really liked about this was it was a genuine conversation about their relationship. Mm. Like, he doesn't even know her middle name.
Yeah.
And yeah, you're absolutely right. The different perspectives. They've never been on a real date. And that was so sad, like, to when they came to that realization. But it was really sweet to see him try, to see him go out and pick the flower and try to ask her out. And then I don't remember who said it, but was it Abram who said that a lot of this show is about sexually frustrating its characters?
Mm-hmm. That might have been Abram.
With the gun.
Yeah.
We had one of the writers, Abram Cox, on a couple
He's
episodes
a director,
after.
I believe.
Oh, yeah, he was the director. Sorry.
Yeah.
We had the writer with him. But yes. He says a lot of this show is about sexually frustrating his characters. And when Matt came back and Addy was asleep, I was like, okay, I'm starting to see. I'm starting to see where that comes from.
I got a question. For your characters, now we've learned from this episode that they were somehow, like, were you guys in high school when you met? Because you're wearing, like, a Letterman jacket. Was that a high school Letterman or was that a college Letterman jacket?
College?
Okay.
Yeah, that's kind of how
that
it
was. That was the idea. Yeah, it was college.
It did look a little high school.
It looked a little high school-y.
Yeah. I mean, like, your character was very down, dressed down, but normal.
I think curious. They just, like, had the opportunity to throw me in a freaking schoolgirl skirt.
And then what happens to your Letterman jacket?
Yeah.
I mean, that was, it held
got
against the bikes.
Right, that was the idea that, you know, that was his because he played hockey and stuff, so. Huh.
I was wondering what you lettered in. I was like, oh, that's cool. She's got a varsity jacket.
Well, it was way too big for her.
Yeah, it was not sized correctly. And he wore it first, and then she wore it. So it was like, oh, that's where it came from.
He wore it first in her dream sequence. And that makes me wonder about the conversation they had about their relationship, because we find out that's also part of the dream. Does it apply? Yeah. We basically get all of this character development for Mack throughout the episode, and then it turns out that none of it was actually
really
real.
Happened.
So do we actually know anything about Mack at this point? Or is he still just kind of a big question mark? Is he just Addy's boyfriend?
No, I think the character development is fair, because Addy knows Mack as well as anybody else. I mean, ultimately, the whole episode was Addy psychologically trying to work through this thing. But at the same time, I mean, I don't think that invalidates what we learned about Mack. I mean, at least in my mind, it doesn't.
Yeah, okay. I think we got a window into him because we didn't know. Even if this journey wasn't his journey, we got to know this character a little bit better.
Okay.
And it does say a lot about their relationship, because he is the avatar that she uses to work through this issue. That means he's the one she trusts the most to have her back to work through the things that she can't deal with. And I'm sure the same applies to him as well, you know, when it comes to like who he can count on to have his back. So
I guess the big question with their relationship that sort of came up in that discussion is whether or not just it, because if surviving, if you treat it like a job, like a 24/7 job that they have, do they have anything in common outside of work? Mm-hmm. And I think that's what she's struggling with in this episode. And like, and there was like this look on your face when he's talking about like the like taking you out to dinner and like on the perfect date. That said to me, like, oh, that doesn't sound like a very fun day. That sounds kind of dull.
I got that too. I was like, oh, poor Mack.
But that's like, because that's not like, you might have gone 3 dates in and been like, oh, well, we're on different wavelengths. But when you got to kill zombies every day, you're like, all right.
All right, this works. But let's go ahead and talk about the dream sequence that ends up, you know, repeating over and over again. So Mack wakes up, Addy's gone. And he hears her crying, and so he goes and comes across a bunch of zombies who are already dead. They're dead, but they have a bunch of bite marks on them, strangely enough, and he's wondering what bites a zombie. And that's when he sees this creepy snake come up.
Zombie snake.
It's not a zombie snake.
It is too a zombie snake. It's dead.
Was it a zombie snake?
I thought it was a rattlesnake.
It was a python. It was something big. It was a big snake.
Yeah, I thought it was just a snake. I didn't think it
was
a
zombie. They grayed out its eyes. I thought it was supposed to be dead.
I thought snakes just have gray eyes.
I'm just going to say zombie snake. That's my theory, and I'm sticking to it.
But does that mean that rattlesnakes can kill zombies?
Let's go with yes.
This was a dream. I'm going to assume it doesn't apply.
Well, if snake venom can shut down a nervous system, and a nervous system is required for muscle movement...
Regardless,
snake venom congeals blood, though, and if there's already no blood flow in a zombie because circulatory system, then what's the point?
Regardless, it wasn't a rattlesnake, it was a python. Moving on. It's not in
science.
It's not important.
You guys don't know what kind of snake it was.
I feel like it was a rattlesnake.
Yes.
I remember something in the script about it being a rattler.
It was big, though. It was way too big to be a rattlesnake. Maybe
they make big rattlers.
Maybe in the script it was meant to be a rattlesnake, but
no,
they
heard
couldn't
it,
get
heard
one.
It rattle.
Mm-hmm. But it's a python. I'm from the desert. I know what rattlesnakes
well,
look like.
In Addy's dream, it rattled. So
They made a baby.
And
a snake chimera. It was a zombie rattlesnake.
They
was
a giant.
Baby.
Was it?
Sure. Anyway,
it was a dream.
So, as Mack's walking through, he sees this basically hulk of a zombie with the Z Whacker in his chest and Addy's necklace in his mouth.
Didn't he call it Andre the Giant at one point?
It's just this big guy, and he's seemingly unstoppable. Because even hitting him repeatedly over and over in the head doesn't kill him. But in this first iteration of the dream, a giant freaking cinder block falls, lands on Mack, and that's when the zombie attacks him and kills him. And that's when he wakes up and we realize, oh, it was just a dream. but then it happens again, almost exactly like it did the time before, only he was able to picture, I know that's going to fall, and he gets it to fall directly onto the zombie. But again, even bashing it repeatedly in the head doesn't kill it.
He didn't try to kill it. He didn't shoot it. He didn't anything. He just left it there.
Oh, yeah, he was going to leave
and
it.
And so it pushes the big chunk of ceiling off of itself and starts chasing him. It's like, way to not double tap. So then he's got giant Hulk zombie chasing him, and he jumps off a ledge to try to escape it and onto some rebar.
Yeah.
Because he has the worst luck on the planet today.
I have to ask how, like, because a lot of actors in this show obviously get pretty interesting death scenes and everything like that. What is it like to be the only actor who got multiple death scenes so far?
Taker.
Oh, man. And by the way, we cut out a bunch of deaths that didn't even make it. We shot so many deaths. There was a death montage at one point.
I want the blooper reel.
Oh, man.
He
pulls my head off.
Oh, my God.
What else? I'm trying to remember what else. It was a lot. There were at least like 5 or 6 that we just cut out completely. I died so much.
I really want this.
Yeah, it was... I mean, it was pretty wild. I mean, and we shot this episode pretty quickly, too, because there were only a few actors. Like, we cut off a day, so we did this in 5 days. So,
oh, wow.
At one point, like, we had 2 different units shooting, and at one point, while the first unit was shooting, then I would run off to the second unit to shoot, like, 3 or 4 deaths while they're, like, setting up the lights and cameras over here. Then we go back to do the rebar. I mean, it was insanity. It was absolutely crazy. What was the question again? What was it like to die so much?
Yeah.
How'd that go?
It was cool. I mean... Because we had all these fight sequences and all these stunts and everything, they ended up bringing on an extra stunt guy. So it was the guy who did like the Avengers movies and like the James Bond movies. He's like one of the top guys. So I got to work with him, and that was really cool. And the other actor who played the zombie was just fantastic. He was game for everything. He was I assume he played football or something. He was so big.
Mm-hmm. I think actually, yeah, he has a twin brother.
No. Oh, really? Wow.
Damn.
Okay.
But yeah, it was fun. I mean, the thing, honestly, the only frustrating thing for me shooting that episode was like, I wanted to keep it as clear in my mind kind of where we are during the course of this sequence. So it's like, okay, so I mapped it out. It was like, all right, so this is dream 3, and this is where Mack is here, and this is dream 4, and blah, 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 blah. And then it kept like changing every day, and then we didn't really know what we were doing because we shot it all in one location. It was like, all right, so there's 7 different dreams in this location, and I just wanted to be clear about where we were in that sequence. Ultimately, it didn't really matter because it was Addy's dream anyway. But that was the only thing that was like super frustrating to me about the episode. Other than that, all the fighting and all the blood and all the I love that stuff. It's fantastic.
Oh, no, and it was really cool to watch. But at this point, I wasn't quite sure what to make of this. I wasn't sure what this was all kind of building to, because at this point, you know, he keeps dying over and over again, and it's just kind of like, okay, well, where is this going? How many dreams within a dream is this? Is this a time loop? I didn't know where it was going. What did you guys think?
Well, what I really liked is that when he did wake up, we didn't have to see that whole... part of him running and seeing it all. We got the hint the first or second time, and they just kind of cut to the point of him trying to get to the door. And I like that editing aspect of it all.
I thought that was hilarious when they just kind of went to the montage of like, okay, and then don't jump this far next time. Okay, do this.
Yeah, and it also kind of reminded me of a video game when you like die, you're like, damn,
it just
start over. Yeah, all right, go this way.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. It was good. Like once I realized they were doing like a Groundhog Day, because I was like, again, dream sequence. I'm glad it wasn't just one dream sequence. After last week with the cosmonaut, I was like, if they just like start off with a dream sequence, that's not gonna cut it.
Yeah, this show likes to mess with us. I don't know what's real
anymore.
You don't
say. You don't say.
Like, here's this guy. You think he's our main character. We kill him. Here's this guy who's an astronaut. Oh, he's not real. Here's a dream sequence. It's not actually Mack's dream sequence.
Citizen Z wakes up at the end of the season, and the whole zombie apocalypse was a fever dream.
Oh, man, I hope not.
End of show.
Boo!
That would be terrible.
Spoilers.
But in the course of these iterations, Mack eventually comes across a door. And in one of the final iterations, Addie's there, and he's actually able to talk to her and try to work through a little bit of this. She's like, okay, well, let's go through this together.
What's funny, during the scene, I was like, go around. Go to the side of it. You'll see. And I'm like, oh, there's stairs that go downstairs. Weird.
Well, and I kept looking at it going, okay, we're in the middle of a dilapidated warehouse, and there's concrete everywhere, and things are falling apart. Why is there, like, half of a living room here? This
Who
is
left
not
the movie
okay.
set here?
Why is it the half of the living room that looks like Addie's? Oh. I think when I figured it out was when we hit the second time of Mack saying, where'd you get the necklace? Because the first time was him screaming at the zombie, and the second time was him actually asking her, and that's the point where I'm like, it's her dream. It's her. Somehow.
And then literally 2 seconds later, she wakes up.
Winner!
But yeah, so we do have that, and we come across this door, and even when it's opened, it's still boarded up. It's this repressed memory of what happened to Addy. So once we do come to the realization that, oh, this isn't Mac's dream, this is Addy's dream, she's able to go and confront it.
But we have another iteration where Mack goes and confronts it first. It's him going down the stairs in that letter jacket.
Yes, that was very interesting too, because Addy at the beginning of the episode had a flashback because she's trying to remember what it is that, you know, this repressed memory is, and she remembers Mack being there. Mm-hmm. And so when we see this, we think, okay, this is what actually happened. Mack was there, this zombie attacked this boy, and it's the big Hulk zombie, not what was actually there, and Mack ended up killing it, and he didn't know at first that you have to kill it with, you know, by killing the brain. And then I forget, how did that end with that particular sequence with Mac?
Because Mac was yelling, why won't you die, won't you die? And then that's when Addy woke him up.
Oh, okay.
And you were talking in your sleep.
Okay. And then that's when we get the iteration with him and Addy going to the door together.
At which point you start thinking, oh, this is the real thing this time around, because the things he's expecting to happen in this dream aren't. And there is a lack of giant zombie. Which is when we get to the door and we open it up. Oh, it's boarded up. Okay, well, you know, break the boards in and let's see. And the zombie comes running up behind them while they're looking in this door. And it's like,
You know, the zombie was probably really mad that Mack took over the knocking down the wood. Addy could have done it just fine. You know,
rude.
Just saying.
Super rude.
I seriously thought that they had actually woken up that time. This was actually real. And the zombie runs up and kills Addy. It's like, dear God.
At this point, I was worried that the whole thing had been some sort of psychic premonition and that now Addy was dead. I was upset with the series at that point. I was like, series, don't do this to me. That's not good. That's not cool.
That's how the zombie got the necklace in his teeth. And that's how it's got the Z-Whack. Okay, wait. No, they just woke up again.
Gotcha. Fooled you. But then when we do get Addy waking up and realizing that this has been her dream the whole time, and she's able to go and confront the Hulk zombie and basically just knocks him aside like it's nothing, which that was a really cool sequence, by the way, when you're just walking in slow motion.
Thanks. So did you ever play softball or baseball? No? You just knew how to handle that bat and do the twirl and...
What's super funny, so one of my best friends who I live with, she hula hoops professionally.
Oh.
And she has these gorgeous LED hula hoops, and she'll do a couple at a time or three, you know, and they're just magic. And so I'll mess around with them. And the only thing that I can do is, like, this thing where I, like, basically, like, make an eight with it, and with the hoop, it, like, swings around. So I've been doing that all summer, and so, you know, sort of the year, so I got to set, like, on the first day, I was like, oh, yeah, cool. And it's the simplest procedure, but it looks really cool. And all season long, I was like, I'm going to use it. I'm going to use it. I'm going to find it. Because I'd always do it in my free time, but I would never, like, get to do it on the show. And then I was like, this is your moment, baby. Let it go. So I did that part. And then, yeah, I'll give myself a little credit. After our first day, the first scene we shot in the whole show was when we get the Z-Whacker, where it's, you know, it's Mac and Addy and Doc, and we're trading with Sketchy and Skeevy. And I, like, you know, was doing the thing, and John was, like, telling me how to swing, and people were like, oh, you play baseball? I was like, no, I do not. I do on TV. Not in real life. So it worked. It was cool.
Awesome.
It was a really impressive. Cool, fun sequence. I was like, look at her swing that thing around. That's amazing.
Just watching that going, someone's going to die.
And she does. She knocks the Hulk zombie aside. I don't even know if that's his official title, but that's what I'm going to call him.
Close enough.
And the door is no longer boarded up. And so she goes down and we see that it's her in the Letterman jacket. And she goes down and sees, I guess that's her little brother. I wasn't able to tell. What was he bitten
or neck bite?
It was.
Which you didn't seem to really care that your little brother got killed at the end of the episode. You're more worried about your mom, which I get the whole point.
Well, she didn't kill her little brother.
And she probably didn't give him mercy either.
Still, you must have not really liked him.
I thought about it. I was like, well, ultimately, that means I had to do that with him as well. But yeah, I mean, good point. I didn't lose my mind enough. Wasn't that enough? You know,
could you just one more scream
just for him?
Yes. It's much more, it's traumatic enough, like some, like your family members dying, but there's like, she lost all of her family members. She only stabbed one in the eye.
It fell on the knife. Okay.
Close enough.
I'm just kidding.
But it's the only time where they can actually, that's actually the excuse.
But you kicked ass with
really
the bat.
Did fall
okay.
on the knife.
So.
But that fell on my knife 10 times.
I understood that reference.
Oh, good.
I should have done that. But that's one of the things that a lot of zombie material, you know, in media, that's one of the things they like to play up as, you know, a big aspect of the tragedy of the situation is what happens when your family members mm-hmm. get turned into a zombie. How would you react if your mother, who is now a zombie, is staring you in the face and trying to kill you? What would you do? And every bit of zombie media I've seen that plays with that plays it differently. Some people, you know, but nobody... almost nobody has an easy time with it. And to see this, it was very emotional. It was very sad and very tragic.
What was the almost?
I have no idea. I caught one zombie movie on TV. I have no idea what it was. But there was one chick who was totally okay with blowing away her family members. It was I have no idea what it was.
Hey, commenters, if you know what this is, please let us know.
Now I'm intrigued,
yeah,
morbidly enough.
I don't know.
It sounds familiar. I'm hearing this. I'm like, I feel like I've seen that movie, too.
But
I haven't.
I was like 11 or something like that, and it was just on TV, and I was like, what is this? And I walked away because it was dark.
Sounds like something an 11-year-old probably shouldn't be watching.
Yeah, no.
11-year-old Megan also caught parts of Event Horizon, so.
Yeah, that traumatized me.
Anyway,
I mean, this was probably the most emotional scene for Addy thus far in the series. What was it like just kind of being in that headspace? Because it's just so dark and tragic.
It was kind of weird. It was kind of, cheated though. I kind of went because I think you filmed it first. I think you filmed the first pass of stabbing the mom first. I feel like I was like, just do what Michael Welch did. Just do what he did.
Oh, I don't. Oh, yeah. Well, what she's referring to, we shot a few different versions. So I also fought her mom, and then there was talk of like, you know, maybe there it's intertwined with me fighting the mom and the other zombie and whatever. I don't know though, dude. You were pretty locked in. I remember when we first got to Spokane. I mean, again, I don't know. Whatever, you're fine. Stage was telling me like she had issues with vulnerability on screen, and I don't know exactly what happened or what was unlocked, but throughout the course of this series, like it's just totally like. Whenever she needed to be super emotional, super vulnerable or whatever, she just like totally locked into it. I don't know. I mean, different characters like bring different things to the table. And for us, it seems like part of our job is to bring a lot of that emotion and, you know, represent like a relationship like in the apocalypse. And a lot of that's going to be really sad and really heavy and really dark and all that stuff. So that's kind of what this episode ended up being. I mean, we still had some of the humor just because it was just kind of funny after a while to see Mack continue to die the same way over and over again. I mean, a lot of people were like, you know, sending me messages like, man, is it weird that I'm laughing right now? I'm like, nah, dude, everyone on set was laughing too. It's just the situation is silly. But yeah, I mean, we've had to kind of represent as far as the
feels.
The feels.
We got all the feels.
All of them.
Well, I needed those feels.
These feels. Good. Yeah.
But it's true. This episode was hilarious and then terribly sad by turns. I just because, yeah, you're laughing at Mac dying one second. And then when you realize the implication of what's happened, it's like it's not funny anymore. No.
And if I may tease with a little, not a spoiler, but just a little tease here. What this does to Addy now that she has finally unlocked what this thing is. It affects her in a way that is very interesting as the season comes to a close. So I'll just say that. Stay tuned.
Mm. I'm intrigued.
Oh, we plan on staying too.
Oh, good.
Anastasia, any thoughts?
No, that was very good. Just enough. Yeah, I mean, you know, you have to think about like that kind of an experience or that unlocking. Like, that shifts your whole experience of life, like, of yourself, of life, of what this thing is, their relation, and then everything. Yeah, like, it's, I was talking to somebody, and I was like, it's really a turning point. Like, it's really a turning point for her, for him, for them, for everything, for the whole show. So, yeah, it's, again, show's very realistic. I'm sticking by that.
Yeah. So, who was the Z, the security guy? What was his... I know what he was doing. He's protecting. He's trying to make the secret stay inside. But who was he? Where did you get the image of him? Did we figure that out? Does that come up at all? Or is that kind of a moot point?
Watching the Princess Bride.
Yeah.
Scary zombie.
I think the idea there was just a zombie that Mac couldn't kill. You know?
Yeah, like what's like the scariest... So we had like the boss Z in, what was it, episode 4? One, the big guy, like the army guy. Mm-hmm. So other than like a general, what's like the... Like a freaking football... Well, what happens when a football player turns into a zombie? Yeah. Like...
And like has the ability to have like lateral movement and seems to be able to like...
He's like conscious.
Yeah.
And I thought it was interesting too that he was a cop. You yep. know, like any semblance of authority that is supposed to be there to serve and protect you is now gone. And I think that kind of also says a lot about the world that you're in, is that you can't rely on anyone to protect you anymore.
Mm-hmm. Nope. You can edge away from political commentary here because, ooh, there's a lot to say on that subject.
No, I just meant...
Well, there was a lot of symbolism in this episode, so that could be a huge part of it for sure.
And actually, I went to Google... to actually look up what it means to have like a snake and a hawk in your dream. Mm-hmm. And this is Google, so please take this with a grain of salt. And I have no idea if that was the idea behind like writing this episode. But supposedly with like a snake, it's supposed to be representing like lurking danger around the corner. Or like it kind of parallels a waking relationship where you're feeling constricted and confined. So
it's very good.
Yeah. And then the hawk is also that suspicions are lurking around you and your activities and you need to proceed with caution, or you should keep an eye on a close eye on someone or something in your real life. Granted, this is Google interpreting dreams.
You didn't just do the homework. You did the extra credit.
Yeah. This Carl Schaefer character must also know about this Google.
All right, calm down, Kayla.
So not to go about like saying that I'm psychoanalyzing dreams in any sort of accurate way, but according to Google, there is some symbolism there to those dreams. Again, yeah. I don't know if that like
these writers are smart.
Yeah. You don't say.
I don't know. What did you guys think? Because I think when animals are in your dreams, it's really scary usually because there's something like spiders or something usually.
Oh, yeah. I Google that all the time. If there's like, I think I had a dream where there was a giraffe and it like attacked me. And I'm like, why is a giraffe attacking me? So like, I agree. Like there's something that's in every dream and it has a special subconscious meaning behind it all.
I just assume if I saw a zebra in my dream, I was watching National Geographic before I fell asleep or something.
Nope, no giraffe
sometimes
watching.
Sometimes a zebra is just a zebra.
Have you guys had any weird animal dreams?
You got animals? I got weird dreams, honey. Yeah. Yeah. Dreams. Yeah, I got like dreams. Everyone does. Yeah.
Jungian archetypes.
Yeah, but Ian, well, you answer, I'll think.
The question is whether the dreams are appropriate for our
Yeah,
program.
That too. We're trying not to be explicit on iTunes.
I'm projecting.
Okay, now I really don't want to know. Exactly. Wait, so you have animals in your dreams and they're inappropriate?
Whoa, that was a big leap.
No, it really wasn't. Shame because we were on inappropriateness. Well, we were on animals, and then you went into inappropriate, and so you made that link.
He's off his game without his beard.
Aww. Yeah, have you just lost your balance?
Aww, yeah. It's sad.
It's like there's a weight missing.
But you look great.
Well, it's kind of a hairy situation.
Anyway, but I do like that the writing kind of incorporates that, and that, you know, for the people who go and do the extra credit, mm-hmm. there is a little bit something there.
Yeah, I think that's totally fair. Our writers are very smarty pants brainiacs, so I assume there's
that know of the fair. Google?
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, yeah. You ever met Carl?
Very smart man. Very smart man. I think that's the official term now. Smarty pants.
Brainiacs.
Smarty pants, brainiacs. That's
the whole load of you.
I like that. But so when this memory is unlocked and Addy wakes up and we see that they actually never went to this place in the dream, that they actually stayed by the creek the whole time. And Addie's awake over by the creek screaming, and that's when we find out that that was indeed her mom and her little brother. And that's where this episode ends. And, what a dark, unpleasant note to end on. Because we don't get an epilogue with this one. We don't get any sense of, resolution. It's just, this was the truth, and now I have to live with it. Credits.
I thought it was actually a good place to end it, because by waking up back at the creek, that's the cue to the audience that we are back in the real world now. So even if Addy is having a, screaming breakdown on the riverbank, there's still relief for the audience that, okay, we're done. This is real. Mm. We got this. So there's still relief in that way, even if it's not in character relief.
Mm. I'm just happy they have gas in their bikes still.
Yeah, that too.
It would have been tough walking that thing just down the road hoping to find a gas station.
And it is sad because, not only do we have this, huge emotional thing, but they're still away from the group. They still don't really have food or water. Where can we go from here? And obviously now there's this big emotional trauma to carry with it too. So what do you guys think? I think we don't normally get to do this because we're normally short on time, but I want to talk about predictions. Nope.
Well, okay. No sound effect. There we go.
Before we go now, into those, I have to go into a commercial break.
Oh.
Because I can't not bring this up.
Okay.
I don't know how you guys watched it, but I watched it on demand on on Time Warner Cable, and in the middle of it, during the commercial breaks, there was an ad.
Yes.
Featuring Keith Allen, Murphy, for Nexium.
What?
I stopped and rewound. I was like, wait a minute, there's no way. It was right there in the middle of the
Z Nation. Is that not the coolest thing?
Did you guys see it?
Yeah.
That explains all the jokes on Twitter. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, no, just I completely missed the commercials when I watched it.
You're not allowed to fast forward on demand. Oh,
that's amazing.
So sorry, I had to bring that up. Because apparently Nexium is the drug that cures the zombie infection.
There it is.
Now, was this an actual Z Nation themed ad?
No,
or was
it
just
she
him?
Just happened to be in the ad.
It's just like Keith walking along a beach. Yeah. I mean, that's with his button down open shirt, that whole
thing. Now that I've been completely cured of the zombie virus.
Yeah, it's a flash forward.
This is what he was doing before he got arrested.
Because I'm trying to picture him in his zombie, esque makeup walking down the beach from the beach in this commercial. It's just the funniest thing. I'm going to have to go and track down that commercial because that sounds amazing.
Wow.
But anyway, before we get too off topic with how hilariously awesome that is.
Too late.
Let's talk a little bit about it because you guys teased it a little bit. What do you guys think is going to happen moving forward?
Radioactive zombies. I'm so excited. It's the funny part of this show. What's the most ridiculous thing we can do with zombies? Let's make them nuclear.
Fair enough.
Because why not, right? It's not going to hurt them.
it'll hurt the people around
them. Yeah, I was gonna say.
Well, yeah, but they don't care.
It's like the exploding zombies that, like, come, they're like, you have to shoot them in video games before they explode on you.
Oh, yeah, and then, like, get their gooiness on you and attack more zombies.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Gross.
What game was this?
I don't know.
Left 4 Dead.
Okay.
Okay.
Left 4 Dead has
okay,
them.
Okay, it's one
like,
of the, yes.
Halo has them with their flood zombies.
The flood. Oh, God, the flood.
Those guys. But I didn't get to see the promo for the next episode. But yeah, I think that eventually they will make it back to the rest of the group. Whether or not they'll make it back in one piece, I'm not so sure.
I don't think it'll happen before the end of the season.
Oh, really?
Really.
I think that I'm not looking. I guess going,
I don't think they'll make it back to the group before the end of the season. I think we're going to be going into season two with them still separated.
Well, I got a question for you guys, though. Citizen Z has been able to communicate with them prior to their separation. Is it because of that tsunami or Zinami, whatever,
tsunami, yeah.
is causing him not to be able to communicate with them?
I thought they said at the top of the episode that Citizen Z had given them a rendezvous point.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I think they'll be back soon.
So they can't just find a payphone and be like, hey.
Well, they did talk to them. They just did it off screen. Ghostbusters, thank you. I just, this show has been one for crazy random happenstance and, dare I say it, Murphy's Law. So even if they have a rendezvous point, who says it's not going to be, oh, come on. Who says it's not going to be overrun by zombies? Who says they won't have to relocate? Who says that they'll even make it there and they won't have to go around? Just because they have a goal in mind doesn't mean they're going to get there. Doesn't mean the timing will be right.
I want more GoPro. Where's your GoPro? Stop being sad and play with your GoPro.
Did we lose the camera?
Did it just disappear?
Somewhere.
Did it get lost in the cannibal episode?
No.
Let's go with
that.
No,
because she had it when they came to the camp, that other camp that with the religious people.
Well, they had to leave that in a hurry.
I don't know.
I don't know. Do you guys still have the camera?
Because you made a comment in this episode like, I need a power up. And I was like... Sounds like Mario, but okay.
Yeah.
But yeah.
So yeah, hopefully that comes back. I thought the whole idea of the GoPro initially was going to be like, so we'd have cool GoPro shots incorporated into the show, and then that sort of didn't happen. So I don't know. I mean, there hasn't been a clear trajectory as far as like the plan for the GoPro.
What is the story arc
I think
of the GoPro?
It was a dream.
It's a journey.
A character. Exactly. Well, I think for the most part it was there for that little plot point in the cannibal episodes. But ever since, I think that initially it was just kind of to show that Addy was kind of this artistic character, a little bit more romantic with the zombie apocalypse.
Yeah, someone who had enough hope for the future to where she felt it necessary to actually document what was happening now.
So are you saying that because she's not documenting anymore that she's going dark?
That's
I mean, that's kind of what you said earlier, but
for those of you listening, we'll there's see. A lot of eyebrow waggle going on up in here.
You should really check it out on YouTube.
You really should. It's wonderful.
That's impressive.
I'm glad I'm not the only one who does that.
Oh, I did. Yeah, I did. One day I sat in front of the mirror and I was like, move your right eyebrow. Well done. I can't do that. It's too hard.
You need both.
No more eyebrow lashes. It's getting weird. It's getting weird.
Now it got weird.
Yeah. You made it weird.
But anyway, we are running a little short on time. We should probably wrap it up for the evening.
One last question.
Yes.
Do you own the GoPro? Do you own a GoPro?
Do you want to give
me
one?
No. I was hoping you could give me one, but
GoPro?
But
you should go shopping together.
Let's get GoPros.
But I would like to know, do you guys have any other final thoughts on this episode and the journey that your characters are taking thus far?
It was really cool.
Yeah, it sounds like we're about done here. Listen, I think... Mack and Addy's, we've been building to something all season, and then from here on out, it just it gets better and better, and it ends in a really cool place. So, once again, stay tuned.
Can't wait to see it. And where can fans go if they want to find out more about you guys?
I am on the interwebs at Annie Awesome on Twitter and Instagram, and Anastasia Baranova on Facebook.
And I am at Michael Welch Act, you know, because I'm an actor.
Any upcoming projects you want to promote or talk about real quick? You got stuff going on, yeah?
I got a ton of stuff going on. Nothing I can really announce right now, though. So just stay tuned. I'll let you know when things are
solidified. On Friday nights.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Thank you guys so much for coming on. It was an absolute pleasure talking to you guys.
Thanks, awesome. Guys.
Great to see you guys again.
Zach Wilson, where can the people find you?
You guys can follow me on Twitter at @ZachWilson. And also here at AfterBuzz, I got a bunch of stuff. Grimm coming up later this evening. Resurrection as well. Doctor Who is going to be back in December with classics. And yeah, thanks, guys.
Roya.
And you guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Hey Roya. That's HeyRoya. And I'm also on the Saturday Night Live after show, the Law & Order SVU after show, and there's other stuff, but that's it.
Katie.
I'm Katie Cullen. You can find me on Twitter and Tumblr at Kiaxet. That's K-I-A-X-E-T. I am also on the Sword Art Online, Arrow, and Star Wars Rebels panels.
And I'm Megan. You can follow me on Twitter at TheMenguin. That's T-H-E-M-E-N-G-U-I-N. I'm also on a bunch of shows here at AfterBuzz, including Sword Art Online, which is coming up in a couple minutes. So stay tuned for that. Thank you guys so much for watching this week. And thank you again to our special guests for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you. We will see you guys next week.
Bye.
From executive producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire AfterBuzz TV staff, we would like to thank you for listening to the AfterBuzz TV network. To watch or listen to other after shows and post comments or questions, be sure to visit AfterBuzzTV.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of AfterBuzz TV.
Buzz you later!
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of AfterBuzz TV or its owners or principals.